Hello everyone, this is Mirzai from Cal Poly Pomona, and in the series of videos related to the special cases of simplex methods, we are in the third video where we explore the third special condition, which is an alternative solution to your linear programming problem. So this condition happens when there is a non-basic decision variable that has a coefficient of 0 in the row of z. So let's explain this condition with an example. Suppose that you have a linear programming problem as shown on the screen. To solve this problem, since all the constraints are in form of less than or equal, we need to choose the regular simplex method to solve the problem. So first, I standardize the constraints by adding slack variables and also standardize the objective function by bringing all the variables to the left-hand side. Now I put everything in the simplex table, including the row of z. To solve this problem, since it's a max problem, we find the most negative value in the row of z and then implement the minimum test. And we implement the elementary row operation to make x2 a basic variable in the next table instead of s2. Now, this is our new table after you implemented the elementary row operations. If you're not familiar with the simplex method, please refer to the video related to how to solve a linear programming problem using the simplex method. Now, in this table, we have reached the optimality condition because everything in the row of z is positive or zero. We don't have a negative value to continue. In this table, the basic variables are s1 and x2. And the non-basic variables are any variable that are not mentioned in our basis. So basically, S2 and X1 are non-basic variables and have a value of 0. So if you remember, we mentioned that basic variables should have an echelon form in the simplex table. So for S1 and X2, we see that form. We see that S1 and S1 in the table is 1 and everything else is 0. We have the same pattern for our X2. However, for x1, we see a 0 in the row of z. So our non-basic variable also have a 0 in the row of z, which is not a typical condition. Typically, if it's in the final table of a max problem, you should see a positive number. Or if it's not an optimal table, you should see a negative value. So for a non-basic variable, we don't expect to see a value of 0 in the row of z and the optimal table. But if we do, it's assigned to a special condition that we have an alternative optimal solution. Let's look at this problem graphically. So I plotted the constraints and I show the feasible region. Now, to be able to find the optimal solution, I have to draw the objective function line. I have to see what corner the objective function line hits as it exits the feasible region. If you don't know how the graphical method works, please refer to the video related to the graphical solution. So I draw two objective function line, and we see that the direction of maximization is kind of upward. If I continue moving out of the feasible region, we see that instead of hitting just one point, I'm actually hitting a portion of line. If I look at these two lines, the objective function line and my constraint 2, they are parallel. They have the same slope, and therefore, as I'm exiting the feasible region, I'm hitting a part of the constraint 2 line that is feasible. And I'm not hitting just one corner point as a result, I'm hitting two corner points. That means each of these corners is an optimal solution to your problem. In this table, as you see, that we are at the point 0.5 for S1 and X2 is 2.5. So basically, your optimal point is X1 equal to 0 and X2 is 2.5. So you're at this point right now for your optimal solution. But we can find the other optimal point as well. All these points in between are also optimal solution, but they are not basic. We call a solution basic that is actually a corner point. So all these parts are optimal solution to your problem, but optimal basic points are the two corner points. So if we want to find another optimal basic solution to your problem, we have to continue this table. So let's see how we can find alternative solution in this table. The alternative solution is found by entering the non-basic variable that has a value of 0 in the row of z. So basically, it means that we have to enter the x1 to the basis, and therefore x1 is the pivot column in this case. Now we have to implement a minimum test, and that's the row that gets chosen using the minimum test, and we move on to the next table by implementing the elementary row operations. Again, when we move on to the next table, the optimality condition is intact, meaning that you still maintain the optimality condition because you were in the optimal point. You're trying to find another optimal basic solution to your problem. As you see, the value of objective function hasn't changed. Even though our solution is different, the value of objective function is the same. So it's what happened from point 0 and 2.5, we move to the point x1 equal to 1 and x2 2. And in both cases, we have the z value equal to 10. So we can see how graphically this happens. But again, remember that all the points between the two points, the two basic points here, are also feasible and optimal, but they are not basic. The basic solution are only the two corner points that we have found through our simplex method. So in this table, also, you can identify the condition for the alternative solution. If you look at S1, you see S1 is a non-basic variable but has a 0 in the row of Z. It means that if you do an iteration over S1, you're going to get another alternative optimal solution. But if you try to do that, you actually go back to this table that we had already. So you're bringing S1 in instead of the X1, and therefore you go back to the previous table. So you're switching between the two solutions if you keep repeating the process of entering the non-basic variable with the value of 0 in the row of Z. One point that is important to mention is that alternative solution happens when your objective function is parallel to one of your constraints. This is a required condition, but is not a sufficient condition. Because if the direction of your objective function movement is the opposite way, then you're not hitting that that portion of the constraint, and therefore you don't have alternative solution. So the point is, do not jump to a conclusion that you have an alternative solution when you see your objective function is parallel to one of your constraint. Also, it matters to what direction your objective function moves. If the direction of movement is not toward hitting that constraint, then there's a chance that you don't have an alternative solution and you might not have this special condition. Take a look at this example that we already reviewed in unbounded solution. In this case, you see that your objective function line is parallel to your second constraint. The two lines have the same slope, but because the direction of objective function is toward increasing x1 and x2 and not the other way, you don't have an alternative solution. So if I had moved the opposite way, then I would have an alternative solution for my problem. But in this case, even though the objective function is parallel to one of your constraints, because of the direction of movement of your objective function, you don't have an alternative solution, but instead you have another condition, in this case, which is unbounded solution. So the point is, even though you're required to have an objective function that is parallel to a constraint, you don't jump to a conclusion that you have an alternative solution. You have to also see what direction your objective function moves. In this case, if we were solving for a minimization problem, we would have moved toward this direction, and x1 and x2 equal to 0 would have been the optimal solution to this problem. With this, our lesson regarding the alternative solutions have concluded. Please refer to your blackboard for your assignments, and thank you for watching.